Well, again, welcome back. I'm LaWanda Jenkins, and I'm the Secretary of Governor O'Malley's Office of Minority Affairs. And it is my pleasure to bring greetings on behalf of Governor Martin O'Malley, Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown, and the state of Maryland. And it's also my privilege to welcome you here to Johns Hopkins. Since I'm a Johns Hopkins alum, I feel really good that this location is here and that you are here. And a lot has happened at Hopkins since I was here, so I think I need to come back and maybe do an event here as well. This afternoon's panel is all about how the Stimulus and Recovery Act applies to and benefits the state of Maryland, and how in turn it will benefit you as business owners to help you access all of these federal and state opportunities that you've been hearing about. And so what we're going to try to do with this panel is really bring home and let how the rubber meets the road with a lot of the information you heard this morning. And to help me do that, I have one dynamic panel here, because you know, when you're the after lunch panel, you got to be good. It's got to be a little energy going on, and fortunately, we all know each other on this panel, so I think we're going to have a lot of good dialogue and exchange, and hopefully as a result, you will have a lot of good information when you leave here. Because as the Congressman said this morning, it's all about getting the information. That's what we're here to do. Let me tell you briefly who we have here, and we'll get started. I'm excited because the folks that are assembled here are the people who have the contracts, the people who finance the contracts, and then we have one of your own, a minority business owner who is actually working on a lot of the stimulus-funded projects that you're hearing about. So with that, my two state colleagues, we have Paula Cullings, who is with the Maryland Department of Transportation, Mass Transit Administration, Office of Fair Practices. Alan Krim, who is with the Maryland Department of State Highways Administration. All those shovel-ready projects you've been hearing about in Maryland, well, Alan Krim's office is the Office of Construction and Contract Awards, and he is intimately involved with a lot of these state highway shovel-ready projects. Then we have the financing guys and the technical assistance folks. We have Stanley Tucker, who is President and CEO of Meridian Management. And Oliver J. Phillips, who is the Assistant Director of the U.S. Small Business Administration Baltimore District Office. We call him OJ for short. And then last but certainly not least, our minority business owner, Mr. Reggie Anderson, who is owner of C&J Trucking, who is a Maryland minority business firm located up in Harford County. And he's going to be our last speaker to kind of give you some perspective as a business owner on how he has grown his business, how he has gotten involved in some of these stimulus projects, what that's meant to his business, and hopefully how you can be about in the same space that he's in right now. With that, what I'd like to do is just give, before I open it up to the panel, and let me just put these glasses on and stop playing because I know I need them. Let me give you just a little context to kind of help put in perspective a lot of the information that you've heard in general over the past few months about the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, and then how that really comes full circle to you as business owners here in the state of Maryland. Under Governor O'Malley's leadership, Baltimore, the state of Maryland, has been able to secure $4.2 billion worth of federal recovery and Reinvestment Act funding. And that's money that is coming to the state now and will continue to come to the state until 2011. And the key areas, there are 8 key areas that this funding is supporting: health, education, transportation, housing, the environment, energy, workforce development, and public safety. And you've been hearing a little bit about particularly energy, environment, transportation, and workforce this morning. The ARRA funding, the ARRA funding as we call it, is really divided into 2 categories. There's grant activity, you've heard a lot about the grant activity, and there's contract activity. And the grant activity is largely grants that are coming to state government that we pass through to local government, nonprofits, to support a variety of operations. Things like, you hear about extending unemployment insurance benefits to people who are out of work. Well, that's happening by way of grant dollars that go to the Department of Labor and Licensing. You also hear about trying to subsidize public assistance programs or funding education. A lot of that is grant activity. And then you did hear a little bit this morning about a sliver of grant activity that's available to nonprofit organizations to do a lot of good work to support our quality of life here in the state of Maryland. The contracting activity, which is what I'm thinking most of you are most interested in, deals with the purchasing of goods and services from private sector businesses or state operations. And so that's what we're going to talk a little bit about today. Now, how do you find out about all this information? And you heard the congressman say this morning, it is all about finding the information and using the information. And you've also heard some of our colleagues earlier today refer you and direct you to websites. Well, I'm proud to say that the state of Maryland, in keeping with President Obama's commitment to being transparent about how all this money is being spent, we quickly developed a website, and you see this website here before you. You heard my colleague Eric Brenner talk about this earlier. It's the state's website, and it's www.grants.maryland.gov, and you can see all of the navigational pieces. But if you go to Governor O'Malley's website and click on either State Stat or Recovery, it will take you to the state's website portal, and you can literally click on an icon for grants and contract opportunities. I do this every now and then in my office just to see what's out there. And literally, it will tell you all of the contracting opportunities, which state agencies are handling those contracts, when they're going out for bid, and enough information so that you can follow up if it's something that your business could perhaps bid on. And so that's how we're disclosing a lot of the information on how the state is spending its portion of the Reinvestment and Recovery Act funding. Okay, now let's bring this down to what is Maryland doing with its money. Most of the money that the state has received to date has primarily gone to subsidized transportation-related projects. There will be other funding coming down the pike that will deal with more health and human service needs and other areas. But initially, Maryland's money, like a lot of states, came through the form of transportation funding. And so to date, the state of Maryland has been allocated for $413 million, which we're using for transportation projects. To date, we have approximately 84 projects that have started. Although Alan, it states that for State Highway yesterday, my staff tells me that that number went up slightly, but the data that we have right now is on 84 projects. Of those 84 projects that are happening in the state of Maryland, those shovel-ready projects, I'm pleased and proud to say to you that 65 of those projects have very aggressive MBE, DBE goals, and those goals range anywhere from 10% to upwards of 30 to 40%. And why that's significant for us is because a lot of states, when the stimulus money was announced and states began to figure out how they were going to apply for the money, get the money, and use the money, a lot of my colleagues in other states saw this as an opportunity for their minority business community, but ran into a snag. And the snag is that most states in the country don't have statutes in place that dictate how state government or mandates the state government include minority firms in their contracting activity. A lot of that happens either voluntarily or it doesn't happen at all. Maryland happens to be one of only two states in the country that has a minority business enterprise statute. We've had the law for over 30 years, and it requires all of our state agencies and departments to apply minority contracting goals to a large volume of our procurement and contracting activities. So when this opportunity opened up, it really was a seamless transfer of policy for us. There was no question that we were going to treat stimulus-funded projects in the state of Maryland just as we do other projects and aggressively look at putting minority participation goals on them. So not only do we have aggressive goals, we also have a number of MBE firms who are working as prime contractors on some of these shovel-ready projects. And then here, as I said earlier in our introduction, we have a lot of MBEs who are working as subcontractors on many of these projects as well. And we thought it was important to bring a minority firm here today who could speak with firsthand experience about his journey of getting on some of these contracts. With that, let me get our panel started. And just so that we have a sense of who we're talking to, it does help us when we're responding to questions. How many of you out there are minority business owners who are certified with the state of Maryland? You've got your MBE certification. Great. How many of you are in the construction trade related business? Any construction trade contractors? Okay. Are the rest of you professional services, IT, any healthcare folks? Manufacturing, okay. All righty, that's helpful because when we're answering questions, we can be very specific and give some examples. All right, now for our panel. It's Halloween, and this is no trick-or-treat. We've got a really good treat here. Oh, that's right. I forgot Paula's got some treats. And you know what? It's a good thing you've got the treats, Paula, because I'm going to start with our two state agency colleagues, the two agencies who are handling a lion's share of the transportation-related contracts. And ladies first, we're going to start with Paula Cullings, Mass Transit Administration.
Good afternoon, everyone. I've provided some materials, and I just want to throw my phone number out early. Just in case you don't get one, you can contact my office, and we'll do what we can to give you that information. My number is 410-767-3934, and I'm the director of the Office of Fair Practices, and Minority and Disadvantaged Business is one of the units of compliance. Today I've brought with me a document on how to do business with MTA in general so that you would know who the buyers are, what the particulars are in accessing and downloading documents that are advertised, as well as all of the websites to get to and just how we do the business, how we solicit and how we bring it to a final stage when we're about to make that award. I also brought with me a procurement document, and also some of the four projects, information on the four projects that we currently have under the ARR setting, which are the stimulus projects. So with that information, you can pick it up a little later, but I just wanted to share with you the fact that we are currently going out for bid, and this is kind of important because November 4th is Monday, if I'm not mistaken. And we have a pre-bid, second, okay. The 4th of November is a pre-bid for the demolition of the future parking lot expansion at the West Baltimore Mark Station. How many of you are familiar with that location? It's Mulberry, Franklin. We're going to expand that parking lot, and a pre-bid is coming up on the 4th of November. If you are a discipline, a construction service, if you see yourself in that type of procurement activity, that's a 30% DBE participation. Now, I saw you raise your hand as an MBE. How many of you all have also become a DBE along with being an MBE? Because that's going to be very important on the ARR projects. Many of the solicitations will say DBE participation. MDOT will certify you for DBE as well as where you have gotten your MBE, but it must be the state of Maryland MDOT. So that's just one project. The materials for that is on the table. The details, the bid is certainly going to be open for a minute, and I say a minute because they're moving very quickly. But at the pre-bid meeting, all of the information you need will be available. The bid is actually going to be due on November the 11th, and that's just a short window. So please share this information if you're not one of those types of firms, because when you think of parking lot expansion, you're looking at trucking, you're looking at demolition and the finished product all the way. So it is a good project. We have three other projects that I also brought information for you today, which gives you a lot of detail of what the project is all about. One is the light rail yard switch upgrade from manual to electric. So those contractors that are in the electrical field, this is something you may want to look at. This will happen at North Avenue, the light rail station. We also have the light rail substation breakers replacement, which is an overhaul. And we also have the Northwest Bus Division heating, air conditioning, ventilation upgrade. Now, with these projects, there are enormous amount of other goods and services involved. And I encourage you to look at attending pre-bid meetings for that very reason. Sometimes you really don't see the project or see where you are until you actually get into the specifications and really recognize that, yes, they will need some of this. Yes, this is possible. At the pre-bid meetings are the potential bidders who are looking for you. And when they think of a directory of 4,000 listings, sometimes to query all of that, can be difficult. When you're at the table, you get an opportunity to market your goods and services. You're able to say, hint, hint, I'm available. These are some of the things I can do for you during this project. So I greatly encourage you to do that. At MTA, we buy an array of goods and services. They're not all marked just for federal funding. And I'd certainly encourage you to go online, download our documents, visit eMerlin Marketplace, and take a look at what we're procuring and get involved. We are certainly an agency that provides goods and services for the Metro, Subway, the MARC train, the light rail, and the buses. So those are our four products, if you will. And imagine 3,400 employees of MTA, the kinds of goods and services that we do buy. So certainly we're open for business, as the documents will tell you, on how to do business with MTA. And I just want to encourage you to come forward. There's some other good news. DOT presented an opportunity to any DBE that bids as a prime on any of the ARR projects, DOT will reimburse you 100% for your performance bid bonds. And that's a great opportunity to be competitive when you are pricing your goods or services in the solicitation. We have a presentation for that. If you are the type of company that would use a bond or would bid on work where you need the bonds, I'll be glad to send you the presentation. And I think when Stanley talks a little further, I've passed it to him because he's a finance guy. He can tell you the impact of that. But just think, if you don't have to add the cost of your bond into the price, how competitive you can be. DOT will reimburse you. You do have to pay for the bond. You do have to get a receipt. And they will electronically send payment back to you between 48 and 72 hours. That's a big deal, a real big deal. So that's one of the ways that help is there, if you will, for the DBE contractor to come forward as a prime. Many times the bond is the big issue. So if you can secure the bond, but historically it's been difficult paying for the bond, now you have a wedge that would allow you to be competitive and to be reimbursed for that bond. They also have a short-term lending, and that's strictly during the term of the contract only. And that information could equally be found on the website of DOT, US DOT. With that, I'll just stop. You may have some questions a little later, but stop for now.
Great. Thank you, Paula. You brought us some good news on the bonding front. As we know, that's a very, very important issue for minority firms. Okay, well, now we're going to hear from Alan Krim, who is with the Maryland Department of State Highways Administration, which is the largest contracting agency of state government. They are also the agency that was out in front with the stimulus-funded projects for the state. They are the shovel-ready department, and Alan is in the pulse of that. And please tell us, what are some of the opportunities and resources within SHA to assist MBEs with opportunities with SHA, particularly those that are funded through stimulus dollars. Alan, welcome.
Thank you. First off, how many people here are registered at eMerlin Marketplace?
That's the state's portal that delivers all of the bid opportunities for all state contracts.
You must register if you want to do business with the state of Maryland at eMerlin Marketplace. Also, how many people are registered at the small business for the state of Maryland?
Small business reserve
program.
Small
business is the same. You need to register there if you want to do business on a small business reserve contract. Those two sites you need to revisit every year because it expires, and you need to re-sign your name up to get registered again. Now, on eMerlin Marketplace, there's a long form you fill out, but it's to your advantage. You need to fill out what work you are certified as a minority enterprise, what type of work you are qualified to do, and any contract that is advertised, you will be notified electronically, And it will be up to you to go to the website of whatever department is advertising this contract. State Highway has a website. It's called MarylandRoads.com. All the state highway contracts are advertised there. All agencies within the state of Maryland have their own websites, and they pretty much show what their division is advertising. MarylandRoads.com is the state highway's website. Get in, look at it, doing business. You cannot hurt it. It was just redone, and you can get in there, and every contract that's advertised is in there. Our specification book, our book of standards. We even, on occasion, throw some plans in there on an advertisement where you don't have to purchase. You can look at them. If you want to be a subcontractor, you can contact the plan purchasers for every contract. It gives you the, it gives you their phone numbers, their fax numbers, their addresses. If you want to do business as a subcontractor, visit this site. It is updated almost daily. The advertisement is weekly. State Highway, I open bids 50 weeks of the year, almost every Thursday, except for this coming Thanksgiving. It will be on a Tuesday. And need be, we will have two bid openings a week, on Tuesday and Thursday, depending on the volume of contracts. Now, speaking of volume of contracts, my team opens anywhere from 300 to 350 contracts for State Highway a year, which goes from labor contracts all the way up to the $475 million ICC contract.
Which stands for?
Intercounty Connector.
It's that big highway system that's going in around the metropolitan D.C. area.
There are many contracts ongoing. There are ARRA, which is the stimulus. At present, there are only six ARRA contracts on the advertisement at State Highway. There are approximately 200 more shovel-ready contracts ready. As soon as we get funding for these contracts, we will advertise them. We will not advertise a contract unless there is funding for it.
Alan, what type of contracts, when we say AARA-funded state highway contracts, give us a little sense of what those contracts entail.
Okay. All these contracts are is milling and paving. There are some bridge construction projects. There's some lighting, street lighting, traffic signal lighting. We're redoing a lot of the traffic signals, getting rid of the bulbs and going to energy-efficient bulbs, along with the street lights. They're getting rid of those expensive bulbs that use a lot of energy. Guardrail, a lot of safety work going on. Now, the governor's initiative for the state of Maryland is safety. And we are very safety conscious on our highways. Okay. My group sets all the goals for all state highway contracts, all local jurisdiction contracts that have federal aid money in them. There's a team of four individuals, and we set goals for every contract. There's a potential. If there's a potential for every contract, we have a goal from anywhere from 2 to 30%. The reason we stop at 30% is because State Highway, in our specifications, the prime contractor is required to do a minimum of 50%. And that extra 20% in there allows him to hire subcontractors who are not minority certified. Like I said, we advertise every contract. Now, on state-funded contracts if there is a goal. On state-funded contracts, if there is a goal, and you're a certified minority enterprise through MDOT, you cannot use yourself to fulfill that goal. You will have to hire a certified minority enterprise to fulfill that goal. That is on state-funded contracts. Now, on federal aid contracts, if you are a minority enterprise, you can get upfront certification. You can get upfront. You can use that goal as long as you have the correct NAICS codes to fulfill that contract. Now, you might only have 30%, and then you would have to do 20% something else on that project since you are the prime, and then you could hire whoever you wanted to fulfill that other 50%, or you could still do the whole job yourself as a minority enterprise on a federally funded contract. I like to have new contractors who bid to contact my office because we want you to fill out your bid correctly. I do not like rejecting low bids who fill out the paperwork incorrectly. My phone number is 443-572-5211. If I'm not available, my assistant, TJ, she can help you at the same number. Yes, sir.
What is that? Phone number again.
Oh, my phone number is 443-572-5211. If you want to come in, call, make an appointment, I will see you anytime except during bid opening on Thursdays.
Great. Okay, we're going to come back and take some questions about the types of goods and services that are available for contracting with the state, because I know that's going to generate some questions. But let's get to the show me the money guys, because this pertains to business regardless of what industry sector you're in. The economy is such that it's tough to go to a commercial banks to get lending, and even if you do have a good relationship, unfortunately, because of what's happening in the financial markets, the streams of money from banks have just started to dry up. Wouldn't you say, Stan?
Absolutely.
It's real tight. So, fortunately, we have a wealth of expertise here in the state of Maryland specializing in financing programs. Many of these programs are government programs, federal and state programs. We also have some private programs as well. So at this point, I'd like to bring my two colleagues in, the Money Men, to give you some perspective on how to deal with those tough but important issues around financing. Let's start with O.J. Phillips with the SBA. O.J.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. The good news is that SBA loans are on sale. As Steve told you earlier today, through the Recovery Act, the SBA guarantee loan fee has been eliminated on a temporary basis. This can be up to 3% of your loan. In addition to that, the Recovery Act provides a 90% loan guarantee. Now, the 7A loan program is the SBA flagship program. I think you've heard that term several times today. To be eligible for a 7A loan program, you must be a for-profit business. Okay, you must have good character, okay, and you must show cash flow in your business, broad categories. Now, the 7A program can be used for almost any business purpose, working capital, lines of credit, fixed assets. But the key feature of this program to me, and that you need to keep in your mind, is that it allows you to get a business loan on reasonable terms. And when you go to your branch bank to get a loan, oftentimes they offer you a loan that's not on reasonable terms. And what's reasonable terms? Reasonable terms to me means that, number one, the term of your loan is long enough to allow your cash flow to express itself positively. Okay. In other words, the SBA loan guarantee, you can get up to 7 years on working capital loans, but typically at banks, 3 years is the most. Okay. With the SBA guarantee product, there are no balloon payments. There are no call provisions. So keep that in mind when you go shopping for SBA loans. Another thing to keep in mind is that your local branch officer may not know the SBA loan program. So you need to find somebody within that bank who knows the program. Now, in the SBA resource guide in the back, we do have a listing of our lending partners and a phone number and sometimes a name to go along with it. Now, this is old, but on our website, which is www.sba.gov/MD for Maryland, you get to the local SBA page, and we kind of update our lender directory on an ongoing basis as we get new information. So if you need an SBA loan, you want to make contact with that SBA liaison person first and let him or her refer you to somebody in the banking system to talk to you about SBA lending, because the branch will try to give you a product that's to their advantage and not to your advantage. Okay. All right. Now, under 7A program, we have a couple of products that you may want to be aware of. If you need a small loan, 50K or under, there's a program called the Community Express Loan Program. It's a loan program that has a technical assistance provision attached to it. However, the only banks that are making these loans in this market area are three California banks. Okay, but you can reach them by their website. One is Borrego Spring, and they're listed in this resource guide. Borrego Springs. Hold on. Hold on. Yeah, hold on a minute. Okay, yeah, Borrego Springs, and their website is www.borr, B like in boy, Borrego, Borrego, Springs Bank, and put it all together, .com is the website. Okay, the second bank that makes these types of loans is Innovative Bank. Again, they're in California, and that's, one second. Yeah, INNOVATIVE Bank. So www.innovativebank.com. And the third bank that makes these types of loans is Superior Financial Group, SUPERIOR Financial Group. And the website is superiorfg.com. These banks, institutions make loans 50K and under. And the terms basically are prime plus 4 3/4. The term is 7 years. So it's a good small loan if you need some working capital. Now, another loan program that's good for contractors is the SBA Express Loan Program. The SBA Express Loan Program allows the lender to use its own paperwork. The maximum amount is $350,000, but this loan can be used on a revolving loan basis. So some banks typically use it to fund government contracts. Now, the key is for the bank is the guarantee is only 50%. So they use it for some of their best customers. But if you have a government contract in hand, you may be able to get the Express Loan Program to fund your government contracts. But again, go through the recommended contact person that we have on our website and on our resource guide, in the resource guides. If you are a veteran or a special veteran, then we have a program called the Patriot Express Loan Program. Again, it's a program that allows you to borrow money from a bank, SBA guarantee, 90% guarantee, and we have those banks that make these loans on our website as well, okay? But this is the only loan program that actually made its goal this year. So banks are loaning to veterans, okay? But it's a very good loan program. It's a fast turnaround time. $500,000 is the max, okay? Another program I'm going to mention to you is the 504 program. And Reggie was talking to me at the lunch about this program. If you have a need to purchase a building or land to construct a building for your business, or need to invest in fixed assets with a 10-year useful life, then the 504 program is the way you want to go, because here's the deal. 50% of the deal comes from a commercial bank, 40% comes from a SBA certified development company, and 10% comes from you. So your equity injection on this loan is much less than conventional asset financing. Now, the gatekeeper for these loans are four certified development companies that we have in the state of Maryland. And on page 26 of this resource guide, it gives you their names and their contact information, also on their website. But this is a great way to go if you need to invest in real estate, construction, or heavy equipment. Okay, so those are our programs. The key thing about our programs, again, are that it provides you with a business loan on reasonable terms. So when you go shopping for financing, you need to keep that in mind. And by all means, shop before you actually need the money, because you know banks don't move that fast, the system don't move that fast. You need to really put some time into preparing for this loan and shopping around for it. And finally, I want to say that a lot of banks are not making loans. You need to find a bank who wants your business, not just your deposits, was willing to invest in you as well. And on the SBA website, we keep a running tally of which banks are making SBA loans and in the number of loans and the dollar value. So do some research before you go out to seek financing. Thank you.
Thank you, OJ. Stanley Tucker, MMG. Share with us your wealth of wisdom of being in this arena for many years. Stan is not only a wizard when it comes to financing, but he also understands the trials and tribulations of what it takes to be in business. He's an extremely generous person in terms of his consulting time and can always break it down in such a way that folk understand what the deal is and know what to do. So Stanley, all yours.
Thank you very much, and I'm sure all of you realize that in this environment and in any environment when you're in business, cash is king. So if you don't remember anything else I said, remember that. Let me say this. We've been around for quite a while, and we have actually four components that I think would be very interested and useful to your various organizations. Let me start off with number one, our most active financing component is what we call our contract financing. And it's specifically designed to provide working capital financing for businesses that have obtained government and public utility contracts. We could provide financing up to $2 million for a company. We could either do it directly or we could do it through a guarantee. Piggyback on what OJ just said, that one of the things that we encourage each of you that you should really start shopping for the money before you receive the contract. Matter of fact, we prefer you coming to us before you're actually going after the contract itself. We have the capability of providing a line of credit pending receipt of the contract itself. You can't access the funds until you receive the contract, but you can get the line of credit in place, which is very valuable in terms of going out shopping, because as you're going out bidding and these contracts, one of the first things the contracting officer are going to ask you is that do you have the working capital to perform the contract itself? And so it's critically important that you come to us prior to receipt of the contract, particularly if it was a government contract, because you, if you win the contract, you have to work for 30 days, then you have to submit your voucher, then you have to work for another 30 days, and so that
or
time
60,
you have bills.
Or 90.
So at a minimum, you have 60 days, and we've seen it 90 to 180 days. So you have to, when I say cash is king, so you have to plan accordingly. We understand that. And so that's why we encourage folks to come to us up front to obtain the line of credit. So that, and so if you don't win the contract, you still have that line of credit for at least a year. So you can continue to go out and bid on contracts. So it's a very valuable financial instrument you should really take advantage of. That's a quick overview on our contract financing program. I'd be happy to ask any questions later on. We also have a guarantee component, similar to the SBA 7A program, where we can provide guarantees to banks. Those funds can be used for various purposes. It could be used for a line of credit. It could be used for letters of credit. It could be used for acquisitions. It could be used for acquiring equipment. And typically, we use this guarantee component as a term loan. The maximum term is about 10 years, actually. Our average loan term is about 5 years. And we can guarantee up to 80% of $2 million with this particular component itself. So, again, it's a very valuable instrument that you can use, particularly if you're looking to expand your business. You need some machinery, equipment. If you need to purchase some real estate, if you will. We've actually done deals with OJ in their 504 program, where they've come with the real estate. We've come with working capital, if you will. So we combine these resources. A third component that we have is a surety bonding component, where we actually can provide bid payment performance bonds directly ourselves, up to $2 million as well, and specifically for government and public utility contracts, as well as we just recently got the statutory authority to expand it to private contracts as well. So it's very, very important that you understand that. And the same thing with the bonds. Don't wait until you need a bond. Come to us up front earlier on, and we also can provide bonding lines of credit as well. It's very, very important that the timing of putting these financing in place is very, very important. What Paula mentioned earlier, that's a tremendous advantage. With this particular program, if you can get reimbursed your premium and your fee, that's a very, very important advantage and actually competitive advantage for you as well. So you should actually take advantage of that program. Our fourth component, if you will, is what we call our equity participation investment program. And this is our most flexible component. We can structure the financing depending on the need of the company itself. We have four parts to the equity program. One deals with franchising. One deals with acquisitions of existing businesses. One deals with technology-based business. And then we have a third, fourth component, which is a catch-all for other businesses. It's important to note that we design these various financing components so they can supplement and complement each other. For example, if you need a bond, then you're going to need the working capital as well. Okay, so if you need the working capital, you go after bonding business, we could use them in conjunction with each other. We could use the guarantee program in conjunction with the equity component. So we have some companies that we've actually used all three components, and we don't do that a whole lot because that's a lot of exposure into one company, if you will. So if we've done that several times, but not a lot. But as you look at these various components, recognize and understand that they can be used in conjunction with each other. Let me give you my website. It's www.mmggroup.com. That's www.mmggroup.com. And I do have some brochures here as well. Let me give you our telephone number. It's 410-333-4270, 410-333-4270. Please let us hear from you. If I'm not there, I have great partners. You could ask for Timothy Smoot. If I'm not around, Randy Croxton, that's C-R-O-X-T-O-N, Catherine Lockhart Richardson and Anthony Williams. Any one of those folks, if I'm not around, and actually you probably want to catch them more than you, it's easier to get to them than I am because I'm running all over the place. But if you call for me, I will return your phone call. But also call, and if I'm not there, don't hesitate to ask for any one of these other folks. They'll be happy to work with you. They're highly professional, and we try to be as efficient as we possibly can. I'll stop there, Madam Chair, I guess we could open up for questions.
We can. We've got one. Thank you, Stan, because that was always good information. And folks, don't get too hung up on all the websites that we're giving you, because we've got some solutions to help you get to them easily, because it's a lot to hear all these websites. But you know what? When you get those websites, you get the information that you need, and it really does point you in the right direction. Coming down the home stretch, there is nothing like hearing from one of your own. And the final speaker we have on our panel is a minority business owner who is actively and successfully doing work on the stimulus projects. And, you know, I know people just wonder, you know, is there anybody that I know and that I can feel and touch that's working on these projects? And I'm very pleased to share with you, and I'm going to ask him to kind of tell his journey over the last year or so about his efforts to market his business to contractors who are doing work on stimulus projects. I will tell you, in my capacity with the Office of Minority Affairs, we're all about helping minority firms make the connections that you need to do business, primarily with state government, also with federal government because of all the opportunities that are coming to Maryland. And I go to a lot of these activities. I see a lot of you. I see a lot of you ongoingly. And it really is exciting for me when I meet you a year ago and you tell me you're really just trying to get started, you're not quite sure what to do, you've got a good base of your company, but you're having a tough time breaking into this wide world of government contracting. And then I see you 6 months from that time and you tell me you're making a little progress. And then I see you a year from now or from then and you tell me that you've really cracked the nut, you're doing work, it's working for you, and all that stuff that people hear me say at the podium actually comes together. That is very powerful. It's very exciting. And I just wanted you to know that it is possible, because as business people, you need to see someone who is doing what it is that you want to do. So with that, I'm going to ask Reggie Anderson to talk about what it is that you're doing on some of these stimulus projects. Reggie was on the very first stimulus project, shovel-ready project for the state of Maryland, and he has not looked back since. So, Reggie, all yours.
Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. I met Ms. Jenkins about a year and a half ago at a SBA meeting in Harford County. And as she said earlier, I was kind of lost. I didn't know what to do. C. Jones was, we were starting to pick up work, but we just quite weren't there yet. So I registered on E. Maryland. I went to every single pre-bid I could go to. If I couldn't go, I sent somebody on my staff. Everybody that said no to me, I kept calling them. I kept calling them. I kept calling them. I kept calling them. Then businesses started coming in. We performed whatever we said we were going to perform. We partnered with a couple contractors. They helped us expand into other codes that we could do other types of work besides trucking. Now we're doing asphalt, milling, and paving. We sell sand, stone, and gravel. But I'd say the biggest thing is just being persistent and taking advantage of these types of workshops that the state of Maryland offers, because the knowledge is that the opportunity is out there. It's just being able to put your hands on it and being able to take advantage of it, because there are tons of programs. I learned about a couple programs today that I didn't know about that I'm going to take advantage of to help my company grow even more. So I would just say, if you just stay persistent and do what you say you're going to do, when you get these contracts, the work will start to come. 6 years ago, we had one truck that was 20 years old that I got from my Uncle Clem. Now we have 18 trucks. I have 25 employees. I hire, on any given day, another 50 to 75 dump truck operators to help me. We work 24 hours a day, 5 days a week. And we grew 46% this year. And next year, it looks like it's going to be about the same thing, but it's from persistence. So I would just say, just keep coming to these types of seminars, ask questions, And the help's here. All you have to do is call these people. They'll help you or direct you in the right direction.
Great.
Any questions?
Okay.
They got a whole lot of them. And,
that's good.
And you know, Reggie, you said something very important just a second ago, and you said, you know, I knocked on a lot of doors, and I was trying to, you know, talk to these prime contractors, and, you know, first couple times they were telling me no, they were telling me they didn't want to hear me. But here's how this works in the state of Maryland. Those same contractors, when they are bidding on Paula's projects and Allen's projects and projects in the other 60 state agencies, those projects and those state agencies are really mandating that prime contractors who do work with the state are also inclusive of the teams that they bring to do this work. So we push them with the goal, we push them with the requirement, we tell them the expectation is you will be inclusive of minority and women-owned firms. So then they're going to start taking some of Reggie's phone calls. They're going to start taking more of your phone calls. And that's how we bring this full circle. Speaking of taking phone calls and questions, let's open it up for you. I know that there are a lot of questions that, you know, this morning that said, well, there'll be some state people at the end of the day that can answer those questions. So let me see a show of hands of where the questions are so we can use your time effectively and hopefully get your questions answered. Also, if there are any other state representatives, I know that there was this morning someone from the Health Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. We may get some questions that might be better suited for you. So if you're from Health and Mental Hygiene, work your way down here to the microphone so I can pull you. Okay, yes, questions. Stand up and tell us who you are, nice and loud.
I'm the Chief Executive Officer of Sun Grace, Inc. I've been to your office once.
Yep, look familiar.
And Mr. Stanley, my question with you is, do you work with any organization that is not dealing with contracts? In other words, let's say I want to build a project and a building for the elderly.
I
need some money to buy a property and refurbish it.
Adaptable
to disabled.
His question is, do we deal with companies other than contractors? And his specific question is also, do we get involved in real estate development projects? The answer to the first question is yes. We do deal with all kind of companies, actually. However, in the real estate development area, we really don't do that. That's not our area of expertise. But we deal with companies that are low-tech to companies that are high-tech, if you will. Is that you need deep pockets to really get into the development area, and that's not really our area, but we pretty much deal with all kinds of businesses.
Great. Other questions? Oh, Paul, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, you might want to contact CDFC, Community Development Finance. They do that type of funding. And they're at 36 South Charles. I don't know the phone number.
Paula, what are those goodies you have down there? Those little footballs.
It's football season.
Go Ravens. Okay, I think there were two questions here. I'll take this question here, and the gentleman in, right behind the pole, you're next. Yes, okay.
And I have two questions. One for Mr. Tucker. Are you just serving the Maryland community? Do you also serve businesses outside of Maryland? And does Maryland do business with companies that are not located in Maryland?
Do we serve businesses just in Maryland? Let me answer it this way. The state program, the Maryland Small Business Development Financing Authority, is specifically for businesses that's domiciled in the state of Maryland. Now, we have, because our financing in that particular program, the return on investment for the state is, in fact, jobs and taxes, if you will. However, if you are a company that's outside the state of Maryland, but if you file as a foreign corporation located in the state of Maryland and you have a location in the state of Maryland and you are hiring Maryland residents, if you will, if 50% of more of your business are Maryland residents, we could look at providing financing to your business.
Great. And was the second part of your question, if you're a non-Maryland business, can you do business with the state of Maryland? Was that? Yes. The answer to that question is yes. The geography here in the state is pretty close, so we have a lot of businesses located in the District of Columbia, Northern Virginia, Pennsylvania. We will certify any business anywhere in the country as a certified minority business in the state of Maryland. We require that if your home state has certification, that you be certified in your home state first before seeking certification here. So, yes. Yes, gentleman in the back. A little louder.
My name is William Wright L., owner of Pro Energy Electric, LLC. And my question is to Mr. Phillips about when you were talking about the 7-8 loans, asking for a 7-year working capital. How do you show a cash flow when you just start out?
Well, it's very difficult to do that, you know. And, you know, a lot of our lending partners do not make loans to startups. You know, so I can't tell you anything more than that. The SBA loan program is a cash flow program. You don't need collateral per se, but you have to show that you can repay the loan. So you have to have some sound assumptions in your cash flow projections to show a bank that. That's all I can say on that issue.
Let me respond to you on that. Over the years, we've done a lot of startups, if you will, particularly in the area where folks are going for contracts. And so I would suggest to you, are you located in the state of Maryland? Well, you may want to come see us, okay, because there are a lot of, in the electric business, you should look at the utility companies right now in this state. I mean, Secretary Jenkins and I, and when working with the Public Utility Service and utility company, they just signed a MOU where their goal is to do additional up to 25% for minority women and veteran-owned businesses. And so I would say one of the things you want to do is, particularly with us, you try to obtain a contract, but that's where what you can do is, since you don't have a cash flow, you could come to us. Okay, and what we could do is we could look at providing you with a line of credit, a contract financing line of credit. And so you could have that in place so as you go to these utilities or wherever you go to obtain the contract, then that's how we could help you with your particular business in terms of the financing. But we also want you to provide us, if you're going to go at a contract, you have to, as OJ said, you have to show the cash flow of that contract to show that you could do the work, you're going to making some money as well. But over the years, we've started a lot of businesses this way. Matter of fact, some of them have come to us, and in your particular situation, there were several of them that came to us. They're now public companies. And so we've been able to help them throughout the life cycle of their businesses.
Great. Other questions? Yes, the lady in the back.
And a lot of my jobs are, they require a bid bond. I've only came across one company, which right now is Hopkins Builders, and it's for a project on Port Eustis. And they are the only company that are going to waive the bid bond, but I have to have a surety bond. Yeah. I don't know everything they have to do right now, but I'm going to come down there on Monday. But when I'm on FBO.com.gov, all those jobs require a bond. How can I get in? I've been in business for 8 months. My contractors have built the Verizon Center, the Gaylord, but still, I have 8 months. I'm new, I'm excited, I'm ready to do this, and everybody said, well, you need a bid bond. I'm not having a problem with anybody saying, oh, yeah, we don't mind you doing the job, but we have the bond. You know, and I also have partnered up with a disabled vet. I have a disabled vet, minority woman, and I have a hub dog. So three together should be in there, in. But it all comes down to the bond.
Yeah.
And coming down there and being new, I don't have a cash flow like that. Sometimes my guys get paid and I don't. I don't really like that. But I mean, it's just the nature of the business right now. And I'm very excited and I'm happy. And I went to the GSA seminar, I'm here, and I want to get it started. And then I listened to, well, you have to be in business for 3 years in order for us to do this. And what is your background? And what is your financial ability. Okay, I'm working for myself. That means I have no money coming in.
Okay, we hear you. We got you. Before I let the finance folks answer the question about the bonds, let me give you another perspective on bonds, because unfortunately, bonds are here to stay on public finance projects. And to be honest with you, it's really to protect all of us as taxpayers when we're spending your and our tax dollars on public capital works projects. What we are beginning to do now, and more aggressively here in the state of Maryland, is to find ways to make bond financing more accessible and less burdensome to the business community. So with that, I'm going to ask the financing folks to take a stab at how to ease the pain on the bonding.
Well, let me just tell you, I don't know if I can ease the pain. but essentially, as I said to the young man before, you probably need to come and talk with us. And what we look at in terms of bonding, because we can provide a bonding line of credit. And recognizing that when you, this is the way business is done. And you need to be able to show that you have liquidity to perform the work, because the bond, in fact, is needed. You can't have one without the other. You've got to have both, okay? And even though if you find someone that want to waive the bond, that's great, okay, for short term. Because what happens, you know, with us is that the system, be quite candid with you, be totally transparent with this bonding thing, is designed to keep you on the plantation. And so you really want to, you have to understand the environment that you're in. That's why we're in business. We're in business to sit with you to try to help you get started. But what we look at you, what kind of experience you have in this particular industry. What is your depth of your management team, if you will? Because some folks want to move, they want to move real fast, and they just grow themselves right out of business. Okay, because they don't have the cash and they don't have the bandwidth and the human capital to really run their businesses at a rate they would like to run it. So we've dealt with 1,000 people like you, okay? So you need to sit with us, we'll look with you and try to help you structure yourself in such a way. One of the other things that you really need to have is a CPA that understands your business and that understands the bonding and how your financials should be structured, so that if you approach a bonding company, or if you approach us, okay, we'll take a little time with you and say, hey, look, you need to be able to show liquidity and get into the technical stuff of it, but you need to have an accountant that understand your business and can structure your financing accordingly so you can obtain the bonding. So you should call our office and schedule with one of those folks that I mentioned.
A woman that this morning who said, I'm with the Small Business Development Center. It's a network of centers at the local level, much like what David Henson was talking about this morning from the Minority Business Development Agency at the federal level. The SBDCs, as part of their technical assistance, has the PTAP program that Alan was mentioning. If you're interested in understanding how to do federal contracting, business planning, and they're also getting into state contracting counseling, that's where you go, the PTAP program. That's a group that helps you navigate what we bureaucrats talk about when we're trying to help you to do business with state and federal government.
Now, PTAP phone number is 866-228-0432, extension 27. Again, PTAP's phone number is 866-228-0432, extension 27. They're out there on contract by MDOT to help you in your procurement assistance.
Excellent point. PTAP is a great program, so it's a great plug. Yes, right here in the front.
Hi. Are there any organizations that help with auditing your financials? Would PTAP help a company do that? The audit?
You mean auditing in the accounting sense? Like
all of your financial documents. They're requesting that they're audited these days, and that's not something that we have done in the past.
Yeah.
No.
The offices that provide technical assistance will provide some limited level of accounting-related consultation, or they'll refer you to accountants who may have some special special information or knowledge of your particular type of business. But as a general matter, there's not a lot of auditing and counseling in the area of financial CPA. You really need to hire a CPA, as Stanley said, someone who understands your business and can really help you manage your financials. The technical assistance folks help you navigate through a lot of the bureaucratic processes like certifications and licensing issues and where to go to lending institutions to get financing, but they're really not going to do a lot in the way of helping you manage your financial aspects of your book. I see
let me ask something
OJ
to this.
Pulling the mic.
One thing you should be doing as government contractors, have your accounting system set up properly from day one. And there are some workshops that are around called QuickBooks for Government Contractors. Mm. So look out for something like that, because once you get the system set up properly, the audit will be a lot smoother because you are in compliance from Jump Street, okay?
Speaking of workshops, I have a quick question for Paula and Alan. At the beginning of the announcement of stimulus funding coming to the states, and when we first realized that a lot of this funding was going to be in transportation projects, MDOT put on a series of workshops to kind of get the contracting community up to speed on what was coming down the pike. We heard this morning that money is still flowing. It will continue to flow. Question for the two of you. Are there some other MDOT-related workshops, outreaches, pre-bids that the vending community can look out for? Anything that's on your agenda?
I know PTAP meets monthly with different seminars. MDOT has...
I know they're doing the certification
training. The 1st of December, there's a meeting at MDOT for people to learn how to do business.
Yes, but also MDOT will be putting on a series, as they have done, of certification. Many of you may be certified just as an MBE, and you now want to convert that to DBE. But you also may be picking up additional goods and services that you can provide that were not in your original NAICS codes. Well, MDOT has, over the previous months, held some workshops to help speed that process along, or to at least help you make sure that you have included everything that you can do. Many times you're in the directory, someone wants to use your services, bids have been rejected because they put you down to do one thing and your NAICS code does not fit it. So rather than have you be rejected or have the prime rejected, MDOT has opened the door to try to bring your extension of services into place and to make sure that you get certified as a DBE as well. And you really should get certified as an MBE and a DBE if you're eligible to do that. That way you take advantage of all state contracts that are MBE goals, and you take advantage of all state contracts with federal funding that calls for DBE goals. I think if you stay on the website of MDOT, you will stay apprised of any upcoming. And if you feel the need for something that you don't see, I would let it be known so that we can take that information back or at least log it into MDOT.
What is DBE?
Disadvantaged Business Enterprise.
It's the federal program. At the federal level, that's like the state's MBE program. It's largely federal transportation dollars, although there are other federal agencies that are DBE program agencies as well, but it's a federal level of the MBE process. Okay, two other quick housekeeping items. There's a lot of information that we've given to you throughout the day. Websites, phone numbers, technical assistance programs, small business programs. This is a commercial plug for a resource that my office provides. It's a minority business comprehensive guide to a lot of the references that you heard today. Stanley's program's in there, OJ's program's in there. If you'd like to get this guide, and it's a great guide to have at your desktop, please give me your business card. I will make sure that it gets mailed to you first thing Monday morning. other housekeeping item, for those of you who need to get back to the parking garage, the shuttle bus will be running right out front of this building ongoingly until 3 o'clock to that south parking garage over on the Homewood campus. Okay, other questions as we're finishing up? Yes.
I just want to encourage some people about if you're in a startup situation, you need money, can't get money. I'm opening a 5,000 square foot factory, and in time it'll have automation to make furniture. And it'll be a hell of a place. But I did my business from scratch. I did put some of my savings. And what I want to encourage you, just to open your eyes, you can scratch out some business activity, whether you open a produce stand or whether you go do some corporate window washing, or if you do
if you have a plan
to stay there for the long haul, I will make it. So, you know, I'm going to be here for you now. In a year and a half, which is nothing, maybe you have a cash flow of $30,000 to $40,000. And I'll tell you something. You can start, you can get there with $1,000. With $1,000. If you'll think of something, scratch something up. And then you're in a position with $30,000 to $40,000. Go to one of these gentlemen with income statements, balance sheets, pay people, pay taxes. You're an established entity instead of waiting to find that magic cash. Build it yourself. And I have a question for you, gentlemen. If you come, I'm looking to open this 5,000 square foot factory. I know all about manufacturing. I'll know about robotics when the time comes. If I come to you, this factory could cost $150,000, and I'm consulting to bring that in and make my own money. But if part of my equation is I have a year and a half of operations activity, whatever it may be, I had two produce stands, okay, and they are yielding like $30,000, $40,000. Does that mean much to you that I show 18 months of legitimate business established activity?
I'll start off. Sure. It means that you understand the fundamentals of generating cash. As I started off earlier, cash is king. And if you have a plan to move forward, then yes, you know, most of us are, particularly I know OJ and I, we'll sit down with you and understand what you have done, and particularly, even more importantly, where you want to go to the future, in the future, and how you want to get there, and how we can work with you to help you get there. There are various other sources that we are aware of within the state, within the private sector, that you may not be aware of, because we are in the business. This is, we eat and sleep this stuff. So sure, that means a whole lot. Let me just give an example of a gentleman that came to us. And he literally came to us with nothing. He had an idea, okay, and he had no business at the time, but he had a great idea of what he wanted to do. He had a bunch of credit card debt, really didn't have any collateral, if you will, and he came to us and he wanted to go into business. And he pitched his idea to us, and his idea was very simple. He said, look, I want to go into government contracting. I don't have any money, but I have knowledge of really how to deal with government contracts, and I have people that I can bring on. We said, well, who are your people? The guy actually was a graduate of the Naval Academy. He really just didn't, but now having said that, he didn't have any capital himself. But we liked his idea. So we told him, well, look, here's what you do. You say you want, if you get a contract, who's going to work with you? He's told us that, well, I could go back and get a number of my Naval Academy buddies to sign on. So we said, well, tell you what, you go tell them that if you get a contract, if you get a contract, they'll come on with you. Tell them to put it in writing. He did. He came back to us. Long story short, we wound up providing him with a $50,000 line of credit. If you will, he convinced his mother to put her house up for collateral, and we took it.
You took the collateral. You didn't take her house.
We took the collateral. but was prepared to take
it. I don't want you to think Stanley's taking everybody's mama's house.
That he worked that $50,000 line into $70,000. The company is now public, located right in Annapolis. A gentleman named was Maurice Tassé, Telecommunications Inc. And we helped him out throughout his life cycle. But he came to us, basically he just had an idea. Okay? And we helped him manage his way to where he is now. And we have numerous companies, they all didn't go public, if you will, but we helped a lot of people with a basic idea, came to us, and they had the desire, and they had character, and they were competent in what they did. And so we worked with them. So it's not that you always have to have that silver bullet, if you will, but if you have an idea and know where you want to go, we could work with you on that.
Okay, we are nearing the home stretch. We have about 5 more minutes to go, and I know there are a couple more questions over here, and I want to get to those. But, you know, it's also Halloween, and we've got some treats for you, courtesy of Paula Cullings and the Mass Transit Administration. This is Raven's territory, so at the end, oh, wait, we've got a... Somebody wants one in the back. There we go. Okay, I'm not going to try that again. My arm's not that good. But we have... This is just our way of baiting you up to come up for the material that we have, and it's good information, so don't leave. Carmen, I think didn't you have a question? Okay. Maxwell Smart provides solutions, provides management consultation services.
Not always, unless you can see yourself in the deal. So my thought is that if you read the solicitation and you see what's being procured, you would have to decide where do you fit in that. Now, if you're a management consulting firm, perhaps you're representing other people who can't make it to the table. And maybe that's a service you're providing for those others who are busy in the trenches but need the information. That's part one. For yourself, you might learn that there is some IT business going on there, minute or large, whatever. But it could be a construction project, and you may have missed the call by not being present. It also gives you an opportunity to maybe network with firms that are likely to bid on this project. Who's to say that they won't be in touch with other projects? But I'll be very honest with you, it's very rare that a prime would subcontract management consulting as a service. It's very generic, it's very vague, it's vague. Who knows what it is until you name it. So go in with, I understand what you're doing. This is what I can bring to the table. Maybe they need someone to do their compliance. Maybe they need someone to keep track of something. So I think you have to drill right down to what is it can I provide? Take out the fanciness of consulting and things of that nature. So no, you can't go to every pre-bid, but you read into it, where do I see myself? Or can I go around and represent the painter, the plumber, the electrician that can't be here today? Bring their information and take back to them for my fee, whatever it is they need. So that's the only way I can see, you know, your business in some of the pre-bid meetings.
And Paul, I'll add on to that. For those of you who are not in construction and kind of feeling like the conversation here has been dominated by construction, fear not. The way that you learn what bid opportunities are available throughout state government, and Alan mentioned it earlier, eMaryland Marketplace is the state's website where we advertise and legally have to advertise every contract over $25,000. You go on the website, you register, you indicate the type of business that you're in, because that will trigger the kind of email prompts that you get. Once you register on eMaryland Marketplace, it is the state's online portal system for bid activity. Then you can begin to see what kinds of bids are coming out for management consulting services throughout state government. The IT folks, the state of Maryland purchases its information technology through the Maryland Department of Information Technology. Do it. Again, you can Google Maryland Department of Information Technology. It will take you to their website, and it will explain to you how you engage the state for IT-related services. But you'd be surprised at the range of goods and services, health and human service work. You'd be surprised at what we buy to run state operations. So for those of you who are thinking, gee, this is a lot of construction talk, it really isn't. Construction is just one category of activity that the state of Maryland buys. Okay, the Governor's Office of Minority Affairs, GOMA for short. Our main phone number is 410-767-8232. 410-767-8232. And our website is www.mdminoritybusiness.com. And again, a lot of the information that you heard, anything that's related to state, doing business with the state as a smaller minority business, you can use my website as kind of a first base and then get to all these other folks. Yes, right there. The real small ones, those real small ones.
The little ones that are like 20,000, 21,000, those ones that are still competitive, how do we get access to that?
A lot of those really aren't that competitive. They're small, informal procurements that are done at state agencies, and they're few and far between. There are a lot of them, but they're few and far between. The relationship, establishing relationships with the agency that's likely to buy your particular product. We have in each state agency a contact person that's a minority business enterprise liaison. On my website, you can click on State Agency MB Liaisons, and that'll give you a directory of all the people in the agencies that are designated MB liaisons. Paul, are you the designated MB liaison for MTA? Or who in your office is?
Yeah, I am. I have a couple
I thought
other
you are,
people.
Right. Yeah. So that is a way to start building a relationship and getting access into a state agency that you think you can do business with for small informal procurements. Okay, well, they are giving me the wrap-up sign. Please take a moment, fill out your evaluation forms. If there were questions that you had that you want to ask in private, not everybody likes to ask the big questions, please come up and see us. Pick up materials. I think Paula's materials are here. Get your trick-or-treat football. Thank you so much on behalf of Congressman Cummings for coming.